Job chapter 2, starting here at verse 7. There's a lot of pages to your notes. It's mainly for reference. We're not going to be going through and studying all of that. We will get out of here in 2 or 3 hours, I promise. But Job chapter 2, verse 7. I wanted to talk a little bit this morning about being overwhelmed, because the Christian life is not a bed of roses. And I just wanted to show you some of the greatest heroes of faith in the Bible went through times when they were completely overwhelmed and didn't know what to do. And because of the fight and the battle that we're in, if you just think about it for a moment, we're trying to serve God, live for God, worship God. Your flesh is against you. Your mind is against you. This world system, I mean, you are being fought every inch of the way in this struggle and in this fight. And I wanted to encourage you from the lives of our forefathers that sometimes they were down and out. And so don't be discouraged. Don't be surprised when you have stages of being overwhelmed. But here we see with Job in Job chapter 2, verse 7, just an example. Sometimes the weight of trials just gets too burdensome. He says, "Then Satan went out from the presence of the Lord and smote Job with sore boils from the sole of his feet to the crown of his head. And he took a potsherd to scrape himself while he was sitting among the ashes. Then his wife said to him, 'Do you still hold fast your integrity? Curse God and die. Get it over with.'" Except it really wouldn't be over with, would it? The punishment of hell is much worse than the boils. "But he said to her, 'You speak as one of the foolish women speaks. Shall we indeed accept good from God and not accept adversity? In all this, Job did not sin with his lips.'" That's a great testimony, isn't it? Good for Job, you know, after losing all of his children and livestock and possessions and wealth. I mean, how this is very admirable. Just great, great attitude we find in Job, right? Guess what happens in the very next verse? "Afterward, Job opened his mouth and cursed the day of his birth." You can just kind of feel, and we don't take the time to read through the whole chapter here, but you can just kind of feel everything crushing, caving in on Job. And he's down. He's overwhelmed. He doesn't feel like he can take it anymore. And so you can read through this, but just to highlight, like verse 11, "Why did I not die at birth? Why didn't I come forth from the womb and expire?" He says in verse 13, "If that would have happened, now I would have laid down and been quiet. I would have slept then. I would at least be at rest." He goes through this chapter and he's really discouraged and depressed. He said, "If I would at least have died," in verse 18, "even there in death, the prisoners are at ease. They do not hear the voice of the taskmaster. The small and the great are there, and the slave is free from his master." Talking, you know, singing the praises of death. And then he comes down and he says in verse 24, "For my groaning comes at the sight of my food, and my cries pour out like water." I mean, he's just in absolute anguish, overcome. And the Christian life, you're going to have times when you're overcome, when you're overwhelmed, when you don't know what to do. Sometimes it's just the battle and the warfare gets very bloody, gets very violent, gets very heart-wrenching. There's always hope and there's always victory, and that's what we're going to point out here in a few moments. But I want you to see, don't get discouraged and don't give up when you go through these times and these battles in your life. "For what I fear comes upon me, and what I dread befalls me. I'm not at ease, nor am I quiet. I'm not at rest, but turmoil comes." So there's times when the problems come crashing in on us. Here with David, have you ever read through Psalms 38 and just really thought about what he was saying here? Sometimes we're overwhelmed by our own sin. And then not only the sin, but we're overwhelmed by the guilt and the condemnation that comes after. You know, we go through seasons and cycles where we seem to be doing well spiritually, and then we go through other seasons and cycles where it feels like we can't do anything right. Feels like our flesh and our carnality has taken over. And here, David is expressing this in verse 1. He says, O Lord, rebuke me not in your wrath, and chasten me not in your burning anger. For your arrows have sunk deep into me, and your hand has pressed down on me. There is no soundness in my flesh because of your indignation. There is no health in my bones because of my sin. Have you been overtaken by sin? And the guilt and the condemnation just came on you so hard. It was like there's no health in your body. It made your whole body just sick because you knew what you had done and how you sinned against God. He says, for my iniquities are gone over my head as a heavy burden. I can't carry my own sin. I can't carry the weight. I can't carry the guilt and the consequences. And thank God we have Jesus who came and carried it for us. Because what we couldn't bear on our own, Jesus bore for each and every one of us, and he sets us free. He says, my wounds grow foul and fester because of my folly. Talking about the consequences of our sins. Thank God for forgiveness, but sometimes in our life there are consequences that remain, don't they? He says, I'm bent over and greatly bowed down. I go mourning all day long. It's really unclear. There's no historical commentary to really explain to us what's going on in David's life and heart right now. This seems to be a different time than the time with Bathsheba where he wrote Psalm 51, create in me a clean heart, O God. But here we see David really struggling with his carnality, with his sinfulness. If you are someone who's pursuing God, you're going to struggle with your sinfulness. And you're going to feel badly at times. It's going to be times when you're overwhelmed. For my loins are filled with burning. There's no soundness in my flesh. I am benumbed and badly crushed. I groan because of the agitation of my heart. My heart throbs. My strength fails me. The light of my eyes, even that, is gone from me. My loved ones and my friends stand aloof from my plague, and my kinsmen stand afar off. Nothing worse than a friend that deserts you when you're down, right? Because they're too good to get dirty. Those who seek my life lay snares for me, and those who seek to injure me have threatened destruction, and they devise treachery all day long. And he goes through, and you can read this more at home. He says in verse 17, for I'm ready to fall. My sorrow is continually before me, for I confess my iniquity. I'm full of anxiety because of my sin. Have you been there? Have you been that depressed? Have you been that beaten down? He says in verse 21, do not forsake me, O Lord, my God. Do not be far from me. Make haste to help me, O Lord, my salvation. And so the takeaway in all of this is just to understand this life of seeking God, it gets really, really hard. And it gets really messy. And there's going to be times when you're completely confounded and confused, and your sins have welled up over your head. You don't know what to do. You don't have the answer. You feel hopeless and helpless. And I want you to see that even our forefathers in the faith went through battles and struggles like this. You know, and that I was telling you about this article about Charles Spurgeon that I was reading. It's kind of a biography of his life. And he had a terrible time with depression. There was one time he stayed in bed with depression for 3 weeks, didn't preach once during that time. It would just come over him in just waves and would really incapacitate him. And by saying all of this, I'm not in any way condoning or excusing sin or failure on our part. I think you understand that. I'm just saying, don't think it's strange when you come into these times of trial in your life. Men far better than you and me have gone through these battles and been completely confused and confounded. So don't think it's strange the Lord is there. Another way we get overwhelmed, and you know, I could make a longer list, but I don't want to belabor the point. A lot of times we're overwhelmed just by our own perception. I don't know who my worst enemy is, my flesh or my mind. Because my flesh can sure get me into trouble, right? But my mind plays devilish tricks on me. and gets me believing things and thinking in certain ways that are just not right. Here, Peter was a lot like this. Matthew chapter 16, verse 15. I put this passage in here just to show you the ups and the downs, and to let you know the ups and downs in your life are normal. You're going to come through okay, just like Peter did. Chapter 16, verse 15, he said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Jesus commends him and says, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, because flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father who is in heaven." Good job, Peter. You were listening to the Holy Spirit. You got it right. Watch what happens. In just a few verses, Jesus begins to explain to his disciples how he's going to suffer and be killed. Peter takes him aside and begins to rebuke him, saying, "God forbid it, Lord. This shall never happen to you." Now, we don't know how much time happened between these two conversations. In the scriptures here, they follow right after. So maybe it was just a few moments, maybe it was a few hours, maybe it was a day, we don't know. But Jesus turns and he says to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan." Strong rebuke. Do you see how Peter went from a great high to a really bad low here? We see in many cases where, remember the transfiguration? Where Moses and Elijah and Jesus appeared to the three. And Peter says to Jesus, "Rabbi, it's good for us to be here. Let us make three tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, one for Elijah." For he did not know what to answer. Nobody ever taught Peter the saying that silence is golden. Peter was the Donald Trump of the disciples. His mouth just ran, right? He did not know what to answer. He's got to say something, so here it comes. Everybody duck. For they had become terrified at the sight. And sometimes Peter speaks and he says the darndest things in the darndest times. Verse 7, "Then a cloud formed, overshadowing them, and a voice came out of the cloud, 'This is my beloved Son, listen to him.'" And there he's chastened by the Lord. And he says, "Peter, stop talking, listen to my Son." We see where, remember when they were arresting Jesus, Simon takes the sword, he drew it, he struck the high priest's slave, the ear, cut off his right ear, and Jesus had to get after Peter again. "Put the sword in the sheath. The cup which the Father has given me, shall I not drink it?" So you see, Peter's perception of things and what was right and what was wrong and the way things should be happening and the way Jesus should be conducting this ministry and starting the church, and Peter's mind and his mouth got him into a lot of trouble. Remember Matthew chapter 26, verse 33? "Even though all men fall because of you, I will never fall away." Jesus told him, "Let me tell you something, Peter. Before the cock crows three times, you'll deny me. Before the cock crows, you'll deny me three times." "Even if I have to die with you," Peter says, "I will not deny you." And all the disciples said the same thing. So it seems like Peter was always putting his foot in his mouth, right? Interesting thing about Peter, and let me just jump ahead a little bit and show you this, and then we'll backtrack to some of these other verses. But there, I think on page 5 or 6 of your notes, I have a list there of unlikely heroes of God. And I want you to see here, go to the section under Peter, starting with Acts chapter 2, verse 12. Have you ever noticed from Acts chapter 2 through Acts chapter 6, Peter is the mouthpiece for the birth of the church? If you see here Acts chapter 2, verse 14, "But Peter, taking his stand with the 11, raised his voice and declared to them, 'Men of Judah, and all you who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and give heed to my words.'" Now let's just browse through this real quick. Acts chapter 3, verse 6, "But Peter said..." Remember the healing of the man by the gate? "I do not possess silver and gold, but what I have I give you. I give you in the name of Jesus." Same chapter, Acts chapter 3, verse 12. But when Peter saw this, he replied to the people, men of Israel, why are you amazed at this? Why do you gaze at us as if by our own power or piety? Acts chapter 4, verse 8, then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, rulers and elders of the people, as he's addressing the Jews. Acts chapter 5, verse 3, Peter said, Ananias, why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Spirit? This is the point that I'm making. If you wanted to start the church, would you have chosen Peter to be your front runner, to be your mouthpiece? Probably not, right? I would have chosen maybe someone like John. Don't you think John would have made a good mouthpiece? But here in Acts chapter, you know, in these chapters up to like chapter 6, Peter is the guy out front. He's the mouthpiece. And you're thinking, Lord, what are you doing? You know, you're starting a brand new church. You've got to make a good first impression. Why don't you put Peter at the back of the line and tape his mouth shut? Are you really going to put him out in front? I want you to see what God can do and what God can use. And maybe today you feel like a Peter who can't say anything right, can't do anything right. But I want you to see how a merciful, kind, and a God full of grace, what he can do in your life, and how he can even use a Peter in the forefront. And so when we get overwhelmed and when we get overcome by circumstances or sins or things in our life, never discount God. Never count him out. We're going to see how these people did this here in a moment. When you think of Abraham, I don't know if you've ever thought about this, and maybe it's just my mind, but Romans chapter 4, verse 19, look at what he says here. Without becoming weak in faith, Abraham contemplated his own body, now as good as dead, since he was about 100 years old, and the deadness of Sarah's womb. Yet without respect to the promise of God, he did not waver in unbelief, but grew strong in faith, giving glory to God. Talking about Abraham, right? Being fully assured that what God had promised, he was able also to perform. Now, can I ask you a serious question? Do any of you remember the story that way? Wasn't there a little maiden named Hagar? And when Abraham was 99 years old, the Lord appears to him and says, Abraham, a year from now, Sarah will give birth. Do you remember what Abraham did? He laughed. Not only did he laugh, he said, oh, that Ishmael might live before you. In other words, God, I already have a son. For me and Sarah to have a son now is just laughable. Can't you use Ishmael instead? Now see, so we read this, and then we know the facts from history, and we think, okay, what's going on? What's going on, I think, comes back to these other verses. Psalms 37, verse 23, the steps of a man are established by the Lord, and he delights in his way. When he falls, he will not be hurled headlong, because the Lord is the one who holds his hand. And I want you to know and understand this morning. And Margaret, you too, man. When you feel overwhelmed and the weight of this thing starts pressing in on you, and you feel overcome, God has you. He's holding your hand. And you may not feel like it, but how many of you can look back in your life and remember great trials and great tragedies that have happened, and you look back and you think, wow, God really was taking care of me. Sure didn't feel like it. Didn't look like it at the time. But it says here, he will not be hurled headlong, meaning you won't suffer fatality. There won't be a head injury. You're going to rise again. And that's what Christianity is a lot of times. It's a lot of falling and it's a lot of rising back up. Remember Proverbs chapter 24, verse 16? For a righteous man falls 7 times, but he does what? He rises up. And I think that's what God means when he's talking about this Abraham and being fully persuaded and not wavering in unbelief, but yet we see Hagar and we see him laughing at God. Yes, Abraham went through those moments of doubt, of being overcome by unbelief. But Abraham never gave up. And that's the difference. When he fell, he got back up and he tried again. And the mark of a Christian is that person who refuses to give up. Sometimes you've just got to have just gritty determination to not give up. Yes, I fell. Yes, I sinned. Yes, I laughed at God. Yes, I had unbelief. But I'm going to get back up and believe again. This isn't going to keep me down. I'm going to keep pressing in to know God and to seek God, unwavering. And I think God could say this about Abraham because of that fact, he never gave up. If you see here in David's, look at David's legacy here. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, "For a child will be born to us," talking of Jesus, "a son will be given to us, and the government will rest on his shoulders, and his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace. There will be no end to the increase of his government or of peace." Now watch this. "This government will be established on the throne of" who? David. David. Remember David? Commits adultery. Schemes and strategizes a murder to cover up his adultery. Lives in that state unrepentant for a whole year. Lord, do you really want the church to be established on that throne? Do you see how God redeems and how God saves? And it doesn't matter how low we go or how far we have fallen, his mercy abounds forever. One thing that you will find when you make it to heaven and you stand before that throne, the clarity is just going to snap in. And you're going to realize like you've never realized before, you are not there by any righteousness of your own. You are there purely, 100%, because of the mercies of God. There was nothing you did that got you there. It was all what Jesus did. And in this life, we're going to go through a lot of hills and a lot of valleys. But God is faithful through them all, isn't he? And we find out that it wasn't my great endurance or my great strength or my great faith that got me through. It was because God had his hand. He was holding my hand. It was him that got me through, not me. But in all of these men, David, Peter, Abraham, even though they went through times of really being overwhelmed and overcome, they never, ever gave up. And if you are that type of person who refuses to give up on God, he can redeem you from anything. There's no death that he can't resurrect you from if you continue to just fall on your face and fall into his arms and surrender to him. There's nothing he can't redeem, nothing he can't cleanse, nothing he can't make right. So what do we do when we come into these times? Let me just go through here this passage in Psalms 142. Psalms 142, here's another psalm of David. He's really down. He's discouraged. He's in this place of being overwhelmed. Watch what he says here, and I just want to pick out four or five points from this. What do you do when you're overwhelmed? Either by sin, either by circumstances, either your own mind or emotions. When you are completely overwhelmed, how do you handle it? Psalms 142, verse 1. This is a psalm of David when he was in the cave. We know why he's in the cave. He's being hunted. They're trying to kill him. "I cry aloud with my voice to the Lord. I make supplication with my voice to the Lord. I pour out my complaint before him. I declare my trouble before him." One of the first things you have to do is you have to go and be real honest with God. Be honest with God. He can handle it. When you say, "Father, I don't know what to do. I don't have 1 ounce of faith to even meet this trial with. I'm undone. I'm confused. I'm lost. Philippians chapter 4, verse 6 says, be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And realize the verbalization that when you are articulating your complaint and you're being absolutely honest with God and saying, God, I am scared out of my wits. I am depressed. I am so low. I don't know what to do. When you go and you're absolutely honest with God, you're not informing Him of anything. He already knows what you're going through. But it's important for you to articulate it because you're committing it into His care. That's why it's important. And when you go and just pour your heart out to Him and let Him know your troubles, He will meet you there and He will lift you up. The peace of God, which surpasses all comprehension, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Don't get off your knees until you feel the burden lift and the peace fall. Continue to pray. Continue to seek His face, seek His presence. Be honest with Him. Remember Job? Boy, Job said some things where you were wondering when the lightning bolt was going to strike, right? Where he said, where is God? I've got some complaints. I've got some arguments for God. Where are you, God? But then at the end, because of his honesty, because he poured out his complaint and gave everything in his heart to God, and God was able to work with him and to cleanse him and to correct his attitude. So you've got to be honest. Don't get all religious. Secondly, what do you do when you're overwhelmed? Verse 3. When my spirit was overwhelmed within me, you knew my path. One of the most terrible things about a tragedy or a trial or a calamity that comes into your life is you feel like everything's out of control. And much of the fear is because you feel out of control, so you don't know what's going to happen. You can't control it yourself. But those are the times when you really have to focus on the fact that everything is under God's control. Maybe out of your control, but that's okay. As long as God's got it, you're fine. And he's saying here, when my spirit was overwhelmed within me and I didn't know what to do and things were coming down on me that were too great for me, God, you knew right where I was. You never lost me. Your hand was on me. And every step was being ordered by you. Remember here Psalm 73, verse 21. When my heart was embittered and I was pierced within, then I was senseless and ignorant. I was like a beast before you. This is another time when the psalmist here, he's overwhelmed and he's telling God, I was mad. I was bitter. I was acting like a fool. I was like some dumb animal before you. But he said, even in that state, I am continually with you. You have taken hold of my right hand. I am so glad that when I get overwhelmed and overcome, and maybe I'm acting stupid and saying foolish things, I am so glad God still has my right hand. And he's going to lead me and he's going to guide me, and I'm overwhelmed and I'm having a tough time right now, but God's going to lead me out of this. With your counsel, you will guide me and afterward receive me to glory. Isn't that a great truth? Do you know God doesn't turn his back on you just because you're confused? God doesn't turn his back on you just because you're fearful? God doesn't turn his back on you just because you're lost? He still has you by the right hand. And his mercy is going to lead you home. Thank God for that. So in times when you're overwhelmed, when my spirit was overwhelmed within me, you knew my path. I was lost. I didn't know what was going to happen. Oh, but thank God, he never lost me. He always had me. Trust the sovereignty of God. You may not have anything under control, but he's got everything under control. What do you do when you're overwhelmed? Verse 4 of Psalms 142. Look to the right and see, for there is no one who regards me. There is no escape for me. No one cares for my soul. I think David's down in the dumps. But what do we learn here from verse 6? verse 4. Psalms 118, verse 8 says this, "It's better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in man." It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in princes. You know, a prince, someone that's got authority, that can make things happen, and it's better to trust in the Lord than any man. He's not saying that you can't trust someone. You know, if we're talking after service and you tell me something, I'm going to trust that what you're telling me is honest and correct. It's not talking about trust. It's talking about trusting in. In other words, seeing man as the solution, seeing man as the answer to your needs. Isaiah 31, verse 1, "Woe to those who go down to Egypt for help and rely on horses and trust in chariots, because they are many, and in horsemen because they are very strong, but they do not look to the Holy One of Israel, nor seek the Lord." He's talking about the foolishness, the folly of trusting in man as our source, as our strength, as the answer to our problems. Man is the cause of much of our problems, not the answer. Jeremiah 17, verse 5, "Thus says the Lord, cursed is the man who trusts in mankind and makes flesh his strength, and whose heart turns away from the Lord." You know, so you're sick, you go to the doctor treats you. That's no problem. You trust the doctor to do the best job that he can. No problem. But if you make medical science your God and trust in medical science instead of trusting in the Lord, that's where the problem comes. And that's what he's talking about him here. He says, if you trust in mankind, you will be like a bush in the desert and will not see when prosperity comes, but will live in stony wastes in the wilderness, a land of salt without inhabitant. But look at verse 7. "Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord and whose trust is the Lord, for he will be like a tree planted by the water." Those times when you're overcome and overwhelmed, those are the times you need to fix your eyes upon Jesus and look away from all else. Those are the times when you need to put the Lord God in front of your eyes and not trust or look to anything else. Trust in the Lord. What do you do when you're overwhelmed? Verse 5 of Psalms 142, "I cried out to you, O Lord. I said, you are my refuge, my portion in the land of the living." You are my refuge. What a great illustration in the Old Testament when he says, God is our refuge. God is our fortress. God is a mighty tower. He has walls that no enemy can penetrate. We're safe when we're abiding in the presence of God, in the refuge of his Spirit. Psalm 61, verse 1, David is crying and he said, "Hear my cry, O God, attend unto my prayer. From the end of the earth will I cry unto thee. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I." Do you know God's presence? When you feel all alone, when you're desperate, when you're lost and confused, when you're fearful, do you know that the presence of God, you can crawl into the presence of God and just hide there like a mighty refuge, like a fortress? And he will protect you, and he will calm the fear, and he'll give you a confidence in his power and in his work. And you no longer have to be afraid. You no longer have to feel lost. You no longer have to feel totally lost. You're safe in his presence. And we need to learn how to shelter and comfort ourselves in God's presence. Just like we need to learn how to be content in God, we need to practice contentment in God. We need to practice being contented by the presence of our Father so that we're not lusting after other things. We need to learn what it's like to comfort ourselves in God's presence, to let his presence comfort our heart so that we don't go over the deep end and lose our sanity through fear and despair. He says, "For thou hast been a shelter for me, a strong tower from the enemy. I will abide in thy tabernacle forever. I will trust in the covert of thy wings." When you're afraid, when you're lost, when you're overcome, I beg of you this morning, crawl into the presence of God. Let Him be your comfort and your strength. Why are you in despair, O my soul? And why have you become disturbed within me? Hope in God, for I shall again praise Him for the help of His presence. Just the help of seeing His face, just the help of being with Him makes all the difference in the world. So that's what we do when we become overcome, overwhelmed. Number one, when you go through those times of being overcome or overwhelmed, don't think it's strange. I hope we showed you a little bit that your forefathers in the faith went through the same thing. You're no different than they are. Men much better than you have become discouraged and overcome. But know that that's not the end. You need to get back up and pursue God again with all of your heart. You may fall down, but you will never be hurled headlong. You're not going to die. You're going to come through this. God has you by the right hand, and by His power and by His strength, you're going to come through. And then one day, we're going to be rejoicing before His throne, rejoicing before His presence, and it's going to become so clear to us that we are only there by the mercy of God. We didn't do anything to get there ourselves. Father, we thank You for Your presence with us. Lord, we need You so much. As we study the lives of our forefathers in the faith, Lord, we're so glad to see they suffered and went through the same ups and downs that we do. They felt lost at times. They laughed at God at times. But Father, the key is that we won't give up. We're not going to give up. We'll never give up on our God, because He's faithful and merciful, far beyond our sin, far beyond our need. Father, we thank You for being with us. As we go, we pray that You would give us strength and rest this afternoon. We ask that You'd bring us back tonight to pray. Father, I speak peace. I pray for Your peace to be upon every home and heart here. Let Your presence surround these families and protect them. We thank You in Jesus' name. Amen.